Yes, I will do a short review of Iron Age religious structures in particularly this region. So, in case you're confused, this is where you are now. It's roughly the region 500 kilometers circle around where we are presently. And what I mean by Iron Age religious structures, I mean in the Mediterranean, in the Iron Age, of course, they were building temples. We have no such thing in, well, or close to it, in this particular region. So what did we have in the case of religious structures? In several regions, they've been quite well researched and named sometimes. So in south of Germany, they've been named Vierecksschanzen, although there's still debate. I will talk about this later. Or Heiligtümer in France, and I'm just reviewing the north of France because, of course, it's much bigger. They're usually called sanctuaire or enclosed culturel. And in Britain or in England, we have mostly shrines or enclosures, sanctuaries, etc. My personal interest is in the lowland region. Many places or structures have been called cult places or sanctuaries, but do they actually exist in this region and how do they compare to the regions around it? This region I will leave out of the equation for now, so don't go biting my head off over that. I haven't really looked into Denmark or Northern Germany about it. So first, Northern France. There are many places which could be or are actually sanctuaries. And there are very famous ones in here. There's a concentration of them in the Picardy particularly. I've also plotted on the map the Oppida in this region, just because we are talking about a contemporary phenomena here. So in the northern France, there's quite a large diversity of structures. And by structures, I mean mostly here, we are talking about ditch and bank structures. So there are very few that actually contain a building within, or a small building, or some sort of other man-constructed a shrine or a temple or whatever. What you see here is mostly ditch and bank and what we call open-air sanctuaries. So they usually contain some pits, they contain posts, pits with depositions in it. We find a lot of animal bone depositions, some with human bone depositions, a lot of metal finds, particularly weapons in the Iron Age. A lot of these structures were used for quite a long time, so during the Iron Age and also during the subsequent Roman period or early Roman. There are a few exceptions, and you've already seen a little bit of this one in Jan's presentation, actually. It's Assiramans. It's a large-scale excavation in the Ardennes, the French Ardennes. And a complete late Iron Age settlement was excavated here, along with eight cemeteries surrounding it. The cemeteries you see are the rectangular ditched structures on the edges of this picture, actually. But my current interest is more in the center of the village, which has a community square flanked on the west side by five buildings that have been interpreted as a temple. So these buildings are numbered 1 to 5 here. And this picture you've already seen as well. It comes from the website of this particular site, which I strongly advise if you want to know more about it, check it out. It's really beautiful reconstruction on it. But they imagined these temples would have looked something like this. And of course, like Jan already pointed out, we don't know how they really look like, but this is just an impression of it. And in the largest one on the north side, particularly this one, a certain ritual could be reconstructed. So across from this temple, temple number 4, there were 19 pits found with actually human remains in it. These human remains are quite specific. They were in a sitting position, placed in a pit. And they sort of reconstructed the ritual as these people would have been in a box. They would have been placed in the temple in a pit, in a shaft, actually. Then they would, after a certain amount of time. I don't know if they're still alive or they're in a state of decomposition. They would have been placed in a pit, and they were found actually in a sitting position in a pit. And this kind of type of burial has been found on other French sites. So this is by no means unique, although the whole picture of this ritual is, it seems to be most complete in this particular site. So just to summarize, I know this is going very quickly, but I said it would be a short review. The French site seem to be very diverse. So they are in layout, in appearance, in size. They differ a lot in size. There are smaller ones, there are bigger ones. The largest one is about 50 by 50 meters. They usually ditch and bank structures. Sometimes they're palisaded, so they're not, the boundary would have been a palisade instead of a ditch and a bank. There are weapon depositions quite often, pits with depositions, and commonly a bone. Scatter like human trophies. They might have been sacrificial and other, a lot of animal bones. So Germany, we have the phenomenon here of the Viereckschanzen, which is, if you look at the region that they actually occur, it was striking that this is actually sort of the triangular region in the south of Germany between the Alps to the south and some forested mountain regions. And the phenomenon of the Viereckschanzen seems to be more or less confined to this region. There are some that have been assigned in France and in the Bohemia, but do they actually compare to these? Because what's also striking about these structures, there are hundreds of them. Oh yeah, this site I will mention a little bit later on. They are extremely similar. They appear, on first glance at least, quite uniform. And they're a lot bigger than the French ones. I mean, the average Viereckschanzen was at least four times larger than the largest sanctuary in France. They're about 80 to 100 meters square, more or less. There is some variety in the structure. And they also consist of a bank and a ditch. Now, there's been a huge discussion, and they're still going on, what they are actually for, these structures. The excavation revealed actually surprisingly normal features. So no big bone assemblages or no big weapon deposits, stuff like that. It seems to be quite a settlement type of structures inside. And there's also, they're not as uniform if you dig them up anymore. It's just the outer shape seems to be uniform, but what is in, it looks like a settlement kind of type. However, on some sites, shafts have been found, the deepest one up to 35 meters. I know there are at least five sites with this phenomenon. They're not all 35 meters, but deep shafts with depositions in them. So they did do some ritual acts, apparently, in these structures. But is it? It could be occasional, it could be local, it could be. Doesn't mean that the whole Viereckschanzen phenomenon is ritual, of course, just by this find. Also, here there are exceptions. A much smaller structure was found in the oppidum of Munching. This oppidum has been largely excavated since the 50s. It's a huge place, and as many as 10,000 people may have lived here in the Iron Age. And this small structure was found in the 90s in one of these excavations. It contained different phases. It has had a lot of pits inside, a four-post structure, and a sword on the south corner. So this has been interpreted as some sort of a ritual structure. If you compare these Viereckschanzen phenomena to the ones that we found in France, not only the size makes a difference, but also the construction itself. How were these structures actually made? How would have been they would have perceived by the people who stood outside or inside? So the top two are actually French sites, and they have very different constructions. Like I said, there's a great variety of these structures in France. It looks like these constructions, they were meant to that people couldn't look in, or if you're inside, you can't look out. But if you compare that to the Viereckschanzen, it seems that these structures were actually meant to keep people out. not just to that you're not you couldn't look in, you couldn't just walk in there. This looks almost like a defensive structure to me. But of course, like I said, the function is debatable. So to sum up, the Iron Age religious structure in Germany, the fear, as far as the fear exams are concerned, they look surprisingly uniform, especially the ditch and the bank layout. They are all ditch and bank enclosures, so we don't have any structures that are actually that could be construed as a like a temple kind of structure. There doesn't seem to be any connection with burials or cemeteries. There is the occasional deposition in shafts, and they're limited. They seem to be limited strictly to the second and first century BC, which is also a difference. In France, they started much earlier than that. Then Britain. I don't want you, again, don't bite my head off, is for your site that you've researched is not on here. This is, research is by no means complete, including all the sites that were found here. But it does give you a good overall impression that there are not that many sites known in Britain that could have a religious Iron Age structure in them. Mostly they're called shrines, and these shrines, they date from the very late Iron Age, usually even first century BC, that's about it. And there are some causeways which were used for a long time, and they can be very old as well. So I'll show you one example, because there is limited time here, which was found in the Damier Hill Fort, and it's often used as an example of one of these shrines. This is quite an extensive excavation. And it was this oppidum. It was in use till from the 6th century till the 1st century BC. And what we're currently looking at are structures that probably dated from the very late last phase of this oppidum, so the 1st century BC. And as you know by now, in Britain, people used to live in roundhouses. So actually, square structures, they're not that common. And so these were interpreted by the excavator as a possible ritual structure or a shrine. So this is what it actually looked like in the field. It's quite small. There are no finds here to substantiate this claim that it was in fact a shrine. So it's just purely based on the shape. Of course, there are other sites in Britain with a lot more finds and where you can substantiate a claim to a shrine, but this one, it is a little doubtful and it's difficult to prove, let's just say. So now, at last, the lowlands, and I've only just begun to look into all the sites that we have here, in fact. And how do they relate, actually, to all the sites that I've talked about around? And do they actually have a religious function or not? That's the main question. So this is just a variety that we have here. And a lot of these structures were actually cemeteries. Sometimes they're used, they're called sanctuaries or cult places because of their shape. But a lot of them actually do contain graves. They're also, most of them are ditch and bank structures. So they are in that respect comparable to the ones in France, for example. And if you look at the cemetery kind of structures, they do look familiar if you compare them, for example, to the Assyro-Mans cemeteries around the village. They do have similarities with that. However, it is a bit more complex as well. This site, for example, in Lom. In the Netherlands, this is also a cemetery. There were 64 graves found here, but there's a lot more going on. There's 64 cremation graves, but there are also structures inside here and a smaller ditch. And what was going on with that? What kind of rituals were performed at that? Did it have connection to the burial ritual, for example? And if you compare them to a French site, which looks surprisingly similar, actually, quite superficial because the find assemblages are very different from these two sites. However, they do still, you have to admit, look similar with the outer ditch around it with a smaller square ditch inside. And what are we to think of that? Another example, and this has already come up in Richard's presentation, is the one in Oss. This is a very late Iron Age to early Roman sanctuary. It would have consisted of walls, so these aren't actually ditches and banks, but these were trenches dug that walls would have been in. And if you compare that to one of the French sites, this is Villeneuve-au-Châtelot. Maybe some of you know this site, it's very famous. Again, superficially, they look alike. They're about the same size. I've scaled them so they are the actual size, then you can compare them. They do consist of a double ditch which would have held a wall in it. They're more or less the same orientation. However, that's where the resemblance stops, because Villeneuve was in use for a very long time, and this one in Oss probably quite short. Also, there's quite a difference in fine assemblage, as the one in France, there were found at least 70,000 wheels made of lead, of bronze, some gold and silver, at least 4,000 coins, 500 weapons dating from the Iron Age at least. Compared to us, there we have 10 Roman coins. And one piece of cremated skull, human skull, that was found near the entrance, actually. So there, yeah, we're not quite sure what to make of this. And we need to continue, or I need to continue this research at least. So there seemed to be a similar appearance and to structures in, especially to the south, so connected to northern France. There's a strong association with cemeteries, or they are cemeteries, in fact, in the Netherlands. Most do seem to be rectangular or square, so there is a theme going on there. But finds are much scarcer, so that's still a problem with the interpretation there. And, so far. Thank you.